Assalamu alaikum viewers, you are watching Al Khelef TV. First news is about COVID-19, updates of COVID-19 all around the world. Trump's son Barron tested positive for COVID-19, reveals Melania. President Donald Trump's 14-year-old son Barron tested positive for COVID-19 but exhibited no symptoms. After both his parents contracted the virus, First Lady Melania Trump has said, luckily, he is a strong teenager and exhibited no symptoms. Melania Trump said in a statement on Wednesday. She said she and Barron had since tested negative for the virus. Further, the Trump says that Barron is foreign when he was deported for White House for a campaign trip to Iowa. The second news about the COVID-19 is from Paris. The president praises Macron's orders curfew to contain COVID. He says we have to act. President Emmanuel Macron has ordered a nighttime curfew for Paris and 8 other French cities to contain the rising spread of the COVID-19 in the country. In a televised interview on Wednesday, Macron said residents of those cities would not be allowed outdoors between 9 p.m. and 6 a.m. from Saturday for at least 4 weeks except for essential reasons. He further says, "We have to act. We need to put a brake on the spread of the virus." Macron said, adding the measure would stop people visiting restaurants and private homes in the late evening and night. He further said, new daily cases of COVID-19 are up about 3,000 to 5,000 from current level, which have reached up to the almost 27,000. In addition to Paris and its region, the measures are being imposed in Grenoble, Lille, Lyon, Marseille, Montpellier, Rouen, Saint-Étienne and Toulouse, Macron said. We have also updates about the economic conditions of the developing countries, said the G20. A group of 20 nations representing the world's biggest economies have agreed to extend the suspension of debt payments by an additional 6 months to support the most vulnerable countries in their fight against the COVID-19 pandemic. The G20 says the extension will provide ongoing relief for the $14 billion in the debt repayments that would have come due to the end of this year. This decision was given on Wednesday about the developing nations until the end of June 2021 to focus spending on health care and emergency stimulus programs rather than debt repayment. The G20 announcement was made initially on Twitter during a meeting of the group finance ministers and central bank governors and later confirmed at a news conference. The virtual discussions are being held at the start of this week's meeting of 189 nations, International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, which are also being conducted virtually because of the coronavirus pandemic. International aid groups expressed disappointment that more debt relief is not being provided by extending the moratorium on debt payments for a full year or by forgiving part of the debt rather than merely spending payment. This pandemic has laid bare a glaring and unjust doubt standard. The world's wealthiest countries play by one set of rules and the world's poorest by another, said David M. Sneer, executive director for Global Policy on One, an international aid group. Further, G20 officials argue that the relief that is being provided is helping 46 of the 73 countries eligible, with efforts underway to expand. Now, let's move to other news. Two Americans and 240 Yemen rebels backers freed in apparent swap. Two Americans have been freed from captivity in Yemen as more than 200 supporters of the country's Houthi rebels are being allowed to return home in an apparent swapping involving Saudi Arabia and Oman. The White House announced the release of U.S. citizens Sandra Lully and Michael Dada on Wednesday, saying that the two had been held captive by the Iranian-backed Houthi rebels who control much of the Yemen, including its capital Sana'a. The rebels also sent back the remains of a third American, Bilal Fatin, the White House said, without describing the circumstances of how he died. Robert O'Brien, the United States National Security Advisor, stopped short of describing an exchange of people but thanked Saudi King Salman bin Abdul Aziz and Omani Sultan Haitham bin Tariq al-Said for their efforts to secure the release of our citizens. United States President Donald Trump continues to prioritize securing the release and repatriation of Americans held hostage abroad. O'Brien said in a statement, "We will not rest until those held are home with their loved ones." After normalizing ties with Israel by United Arab Emirates and Bahrain, America also tries to normalize the ties between the Saudi Arabia and the Israel. For that purpose, Pompeo urged Saudi Arabia to normalize ties with Israel. United States Secretary of State Mike Pompeo has urged Saudi Arabia to recognize Israel in what would be a strategic boost for the Jewish state amid normalization with other two countries. Bahrain, which tightly coordinates its foreign policy with Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates, on September 15 signed the so-called Abraham Accords with Israel at the White House. Palestinian officials condemned the normalization as a stab in the back of the Palestinian cause and the Palestinian people. Meeting Saudi Foreign Minister Franz Faisal bin Farhan in Washington, D.C. on Wednesday, Pompeo said, "The agreement contributed greatly to our shared goals for regional peace and security. They reflect a changing dynamics in the region, one in which countries rightly recognize the need for regional cooperation to counter Iranian influence and generate prosperity," Pompeo said. "We hope Saudi Arabia will consider normalizing its relationship as well. We want to thank them for the assistance they have had in the success of the Abraham Accords so far." He further added that he hopes the kingdom will encourage Palestinian leaders or the Palestinian Authority to return to negotiation with Israel. The United States is trying to persuade more Gulf countries to strike similar accords with Israel as the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain did at the September 15 ceremony in Washington, D.C. Riyadh has quietly agreed to the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain deals, though it has stopped short of endorsing them and has signaled it is not ready to take action itself. Saudi Arabia, the birthplace of Islam and site of its holiest shrines, drew up a 2002 initiative under which Arab nations afford to normalize ties with Israel in return for a statehood deal with the Palestinians and full Israeli withdrawal from territory captured in 1967. Further, Middle East analysts have raised questions and concerns about the consequences of the Arab-Israeli normalization in the region.